12.3.2. This is Einstein's theory of special relativity. So, we're going to talk about frames of references and a special case called the inertial frame of reference. So, a frame of reference is just where you observe things from. And if you want to observe things, you normally want to be in something called the inertial frame of reference. So we're going to think about a train that's moving and a ball that's on the train. In the frame of reference of the ball, or in the frame of reference of the train, the ball or the train appears not to move. So if you have a ball on a train and it's sitting on the train, it remains where it is in the train. And as long as you can't see the outside world, everything appears to be stationary. Assuming we're on tracks that are so perfect that they don't bounce up and down at all, and the train is not accelerating at all, so it's at constant speed, it appears to be stationary. Now, if the ball moves by itself, not with the train, so if the ball appears to move relative to the train, it's no longer in an inertial frame of reference. So if the ball moves by itself, and I'll put here without the train, then it's not in an inertial frame of reference. And that means that the ball has accelerated. So places which appear to rotate or accelerate are not inertial frames of reference. E.g., if we're on a lab on Earth, while the Earth is rotating and it has an acceleration, when we're on the Earth, we don't perceive that because we're in an inertial frame of reference. So if I measure a distance in a lab on the Earth, that length of some object doesn't appear to change in any way. If I was not on the Earth, outside of the Earth, watching the Earth move and rotate and at the same time trying to observe something in a lab, like a length, then I would observe that differently to how I would have done if I was in the lab myself. So if I was in the inertial frame of reference. So places which accelerate or rotate are not inertial frames of reference. Let's do one example of this. Imagine muons raining down from the sky. So cosmic muons, they've come from outer space. Muons have a time in which they decay. So they have a decay time or a half-life. From the perspective of the muon measuring its own lifetime, That is the muon's inertial frame of reference. But for us on the surface of the Earth, watching those muons, we're in a non-inertial frame of reference. So, we've got an observer on the ground. We have some mountain. At the top of a mountain, we have a lab. So we can take measurements at that lab. We have muons moving down. If we take a measurement of how many muons are passing by a lab at the top of a mountain, and we know the lifetime of muons, then we can estimate how many muons should be left that reach the ground. When these observations are made, we don't get the results we expect. So the muon is the inertial frame. And we say that the person at the bottom is the moving observer. So if you were to measure your lifetime as the muon, you get less time than if you measured the time or the clock as the moving observer. So the times don't match up. So the clock for muon shows less time has passed than the clock for moving observer. So the observer expects that most of these muons should have decayed by the time they reach the bottom. But actually what they find is that most of these muons actually make it to the bottom without having decayed yet. So the reason why this happens is the muons are moving very quickly. When things move fast and they approach near to the speed of light, certain phenomena begin to occur. One, length contraction. So the length of the distance that the muons perceive to have moved is different to the length that we as the moving observer have observed them to have moved in. Second is time dilation. The time at which the muons have observed themselves to have moved is different to the time that we observed them to have moved. So the muons have observed themselves as moving less time. We observe them as moving for a longer time. And so the times that we measure in the muon's frame of reference versus our own frame of reference are different. And that's why we end up seeing them not have decayed by the time they reach the bottom, when they should have done. And that's the start of special relativity. So before we begin, I'm going to give you some definitions that you need to know. So one of them we already talked about in the last lesson, which is that speed of light is invariant. So that means in any frame of reference, even if we're almost moving at the speed of light, if I shine some light relative to me, it still moves 3 × 10⁸ meters per second. That's quite perplexing. It's surely if I'm moving almost at the speed of light and I shine light, it should appear to not move as fast, but it still appears to move at the speed of light. And another is that the laws of physics remain true in any inertial frame of reference. That means as long as you're in an inertial frame of reference, the laws of physics do not need to be modified and they'll result in the same observations in any inertial frame. Even if you've changed inertial frames to a different one, the laws of physics remain true. If you're in a non-inertial frame of reference, then the laws of physics appear to have changed when you do your observations. E.g., the muons appeared not to decay at the time that they were supposed to decay. It appears that they've outlived their lifetime. So doing an experiment in any inertial frame will yield the same results. And that's the end of 12.3.2.